The Thinking Out Loud series, a series of stimulating conversations on topics that matter. It's about connecting Concordia research to the public. It's about getting beyond sound bites and digging deeper. So let's get started. Please join me in welcoming tonight's moderator from the Globe and Mail, Erin Anderssen, and our conversationalist this evening, Professor Fenwick McKelvey and author William Gibson.
Well, bonsoir, good evening. I'm sure we're all very happy to be here. It's an honor for me to be here doing this tonight. Our topic, digital lives, digital identities in the future, is obviously one that affects us all. It's a necessity today, an obsession, a bit of a frustration. Cutting into some of the major topics, politics, and our social life. So I guess to open, why don't we explore, is there a value today in talking about our digital lives as being separate from our real world lives? Bill?
I think it's old fashioned. I think it's traditional and it's generational, and I don't expect future generations to make that distinction. I think they'll find the way in which we made that distinction really peculiar, and they'll try very hard to understand it, much in the way that they'll try very hard to understand all of the art and fiction produced in a world in which most people experienced really what to the future will be a remarkable degree of isolation quite a lot of the time. And if connectivity continues to increase, people won't be alone. And very young people today aren't alone very often at all.
Anyway?
Well, I was struck by Mr. Gibson, at one point you were describing the idea of like a cyborg, you know, in the idea of how we were coming increasingly, or that the concept of cyborg was something that allowed us to understand a bit better our relationship with technology. And I think that that's actually, to me, that concept is one I think has been throughout our history as a relationship technology. You know, we're always kind of increasingly defined by it. And so the divide between the digital and the real today is as abstract, I think, as something you could say in the past about, you know, what it would be like the pen and the written word and the self. And I think that those things are increasingly intertwined. And yeah, I think that what's helpful is understanding ourselves as something that's, you know, simultaneously, you know, digital and real. And that's part of how we articulate or express ourselves, you know, that we're all basically cyborgs. Mm.
It's interesting, Bill, you talked about isolation and the lack of ever feeling alone or solitary. You know, I know people talk a lot about always having to be connected, always feeling on. Where do you see that going in the future? Is the solitary moments going to become a new commodity, something that we're seeking, or are we just going to accept that we don't have those moments anymore?
Well, you know, so maybe 20 years ago, I wrote a novel in which a young girl mentioned that her mother was on a media fast. A young girl in an imagined future, but and since then I've heard people talk about media fasting. It's like you're going into this strange world where you have no connectivity, and so I don't. Yeah, I remember being in. I happened to be in London about 2 weeks before. Everybody seemingly in Great Britain got at least one cell phone, maybe two. And at that point, no one I knew in Vancouver had a cell phone. So I was on a tube platform in winter, looking at people thinking about the incredible solitude of British tube travel. They don't talk and they don't make eye contact. And I was thinking about Ezra, that Ezra Pound poem, Petals on a Wet Black Bough, is seeing the commuters waiting in the tube, and how lonely it was. And part of what I was thinking was, it's eternal, the very soul of London. So as it happened, I had to wind up having to come back from Vancouver a month later, and everybody was there with a cell phone. And I thought, it's gone. It's gone. The solitude of the tube is gone. And it was gone. It's not coming back. Hmm. And I think we experience that continually and don't, probably most of us don't notice it. We don't notice the last time before some emergent technology ends something that we've grown up with.
Do you notice any of those moments in hindsight for yourself personally?
I can't think of one at the moment personally, but sometimes I'll open a drawer and see some discarded piece of, some forgotten piece of personal technology which once was very important to me. Or I'll see one like the one I used to have, but I'll see it in a thrift shop. And I was at a swap meet in Vancouver years ago, and there were these reels of really weird-looking, slightly rusty, brittle steel wire under a dealer's card table. And they were wrapped around something that was similar to, but not identical to, the reels that 35-millimeter theater film used to be wound around. And I was kind of going, this stuff's like so brittle. And so I said, what is this? And he said, wire recordings. And I said, I've heard about it, but I've never even seen the machine. I said, is there still audio on these things? And he said, who knows? And that was like a literal and powerful experience of what Bruce Sterling calls a dead platform. And they probably wound up in landfill, and they might have had audio. I subsequently went by CBC and the old CBC building in Vancouver when they were clearing it out to move to their new building, and there was a dumpster full of those things. And it was probably going to a metal recycling place. Who knows what was on it or how old they were. We'll never have access to whatever that was.
It's lost.
Yeah.
It's lost now. Well, I guess one of the other things that we worry about losing is our attention. We were talking backstage about the phrase continuous partial attention. Fenwick, what's the risk for that for us? We're never really singularly focused on one thing.
Well, part of the challenge is that I think in this day and age, where I'm noticing this shift from what we talk about as the dead media platform, but this transition, I think, from broadcasting media to kind of an era of social media. And that's much more complex articulation of what is attention and how do we attend to things. And so it's, I think, one of the questions is why we talk about continuous partial attention is trying to actually understand how we come as a society to find things that are important. And there was a moment where you could say that this was being broadcast. And I think what concerns me or what interests me is the different ways that we come. And there are, I think, more attuned ways that might have been with oral traditions of how things would pass word of mouth. But these questions that now we have of how do things become popular, how do we attend to things because of being raised or alerted through social media, and then particularly how those companies are very aware of that, of cultivating these new practices of attending to things.
Well, I mean, isn't that, I mean, I guess you raise an interesting point, because if our attention has become so valuable to all these corporations and social media companies, do we give it away willy-nilly, or are we, have we forgotten to be intentional with that, that valuable commodity? Bill, what do you think?
I don't know if we can know what we've given away to a new technology. I think that when we embrace or take on a new technology, we become it in somewhat in the way that I was taught in Anthropology 101, that one could not know one's own culture. That one had a chance of comprehending the other's culture, but one's own culture is unknowable because it is the lens through which we view everything. And I think one of the most mysterious things about technology is the way in which we lose the previous mode of existence. For instance, a thought experiment that anyone can try is to try to imagine what the world was like prior to the invention of recorded music. Like, what would music have been like when you could never hear recorded music? You could only hear live music. And I've tried that any number of times, and it always breaks down for me. I find it literally, literally unimaginable, because I am that which has always had access to recorded music.
It's also interesting, like, not only access to recorded music, but access to it all on demand. I think that that's also something in talking about part of this constitution of the digital, you know, is how things are just available on demand, like a sort of standing reserve of possibility that is consumed both by, you know, young music consumers and the CSIS, you know, depending on who's interested.
When the only way that most people could see a movie was to go to a theater when that movie was in theatrical release, the experience of seeing a movie was fundamentally different. It was different in so many ways that now it's difficult to remember how different it was. I happened to see Chris Marker's La Jetée in a film history course at UBC with no idea what I was about to see, and it was a powerfully formative experience for me. It certainly changed my idea of what science fiction in any medium is capable of. And I left the lecture hall in shock, really. And then I was absolutely unable to see it again for a decade. There was no way I could see it. There were no videotapes. I happened by accident to see it again on television. And just as it became possible, just as access to everything became possible. But there was something in not seeing it again that made the memory of it incredibly powerful. It was a very, very different experience. To not, and to live in a world without rewind, where nothing could be rewound, where everything was forward, over, and then you had to see something else. You had no chance to replay the film you had just seen. You experienced it repeatedly in memory, where it no doubt morphed into something that bore little resemblance to what you had actually seen. That's so different that it's quite a bit of work to remember it, and more work to try to reconstruct it if you've never had that experience.
It's funny, in my time, I've gone from being someone who could remember phone numbers to no longer remembering phone numbers, because they're all recorded. Yeah, so yeah. The names and phone numbers are two of my big faults in remembering. But the idea is that all of a sudden you've delegated that memory to the phone, and so that question that we have about how much of ourselves is kind of dependent upon a kind of supporting, you know, these dependent technologies, you know, these aspects of our memory that have become more like a cyborg, and that question of how we can might be able to look back and look at how we have changed our processes and practices of remembering, and the fact that everything now is written down intentionally or unintentionally in large part. And even imagine that in the future, the show Black Mirror, which is quite popular, has been talking about did an episode of an implant where you remembered everything, and the horror that would be, where you could rewind your entire life. And that, I think, distinction from constantly being in kind of like constant communication, in this moment we have now, and that the record that creates, and then those potential moments of being off the record.
And, well, it's your phone is a complex prosthesis in a sense, that we no longer have to remember numbers because we have a prosthesis which is with us almost all the time that remembers numbers for us. But having to remember the numbers is just a waste of available memory buffer, I think. I mean, there's no virtue in being able to remember the numbers unless you're a bookie, say. There are areas of society where being able to remember numbers is still a valuable thing, but phone numbers, assuming you have a phone, it's what were we gaining from that?
It's interesting you talk about that, because you're saying we've cleared up our brain space, we don't have to remember incidental facts or phone numbers. So that should make us smarter and able to delve deeper into topics, but a lot of people would argue that the opposite has happened, that we're more surface dwellers now when it comes to information.
Well, I know that argument, but I'm familiar with that argument, but I've never found it particularly convincing. Not for most information. If you're attempting to master a particular field of knowledge, I think you still have to absorb it whole. But then when you've mastered it in your practice of it, I would imagine that you would assign a lot of the phone numbers to a convenient prosthesis, because you'd want to free up your own processing for whatever it is that you're working on.
I also like the Onion just had that a new piece about Facebook. We're launching a new alert message that alerts you when you're not looking at Facebook. but all to say is that some of the question here is not only just distraction, but the drivers of distraction. And the question being is that the work being done by, I think this was interest me when you're talking about media policy, but the kind of emerging platforms and their ways of creating it so that they are reminding us or constructing our attention. And like, you know, we were talking a bit about commodifying Twitter, and part of what's going on is there's a habituating us to kind of watch a feed or a flow, and the insertion of advertisements within that flow. And the question being is that how is that, and this is something that's, you know, the fantastic in the department when you talk about media history and media archaeology, but how is that construction of a flow similar or different than television, right? Because in television it was about a continuous viewing experience, and how is it that we're being habituated to have this kind of never-ending feed that we'll just occasionally have interruptions that we will pay attention to?
Yeah.
Well, I guess it's also a question, because you were saying about everything being available all the time, but some of it's available because we go looking for it, and a lot of it is delivered to us, drawn to our attention. So how much are we in control in our digital lives of what we're seeing and what some invisible entity is intending for us to see? Where are we, how autonomous are we in that exchange of information?
Well, I think it varies from individual to individual. It probably varies in a given individual over the course of a single day. I feel more autonomous in that activity at some times, certainly than I do at other times. One thing that haunts me about my life in the digital is that probably statistically the strangest thing about me, the thing about me that makes me most a demographic outlier in my age cohort is that after age 15 or 16, I didn't watch television. I saw very little broadcast television for over a decade, for about 14 years. I went from being a 16-year-old in a boarding school in Arizona to living with countercultural people who didn't watch television, and they didn't have television. We did other things, and I had a completely normal television existence until that point. So there's this gap where I didn't absorb any of the broadcast hierarchic top-down stuff, unless Nixon was resigning or something, and then we'd go to someone's house who had a television, or their parents had a television, and I think that had a profound effect on me, and I suspect it. There were ways in which it was quite advantageous, and now in the land of the new platforms, I've become the digital equivalent of someone who watches television all day. And I sometimes look at that and go, ooh, is this? Because, by not watching television, I freed up an enormous amount of time to do other things, to read all kinds of things and investigate things I was interested in. And all around me, I would see people that were watching broadcast television, and it was mostly like terrible episodic drama from the United States and not, you know, not very accurately presented news. I would look over their shoulders and see what it was and just go, I don't get it. But they were all totally into it. And the way they're totally into it is sort of the way I'm totally into Twitter. So I don't know.
Well, you bring up Twitter. You told me a great story earlier tonight about, I guess, William Gibson as public citizen serving during the earthquake, and I thought that was a great anecdote. Do you mind sharing that?
I was sitting at home one evening with my iPad, looking at my Twitter feed. And someone I knew only from Twitter, I still haven't met this person, but I knew that he lived in Tokyo and had lived there for a while. And I had a sense of him. I followed him. And because I followed him, I saw a tweet of his as it appeared that said something like, I think it was in all caps, it said, earthquake, big one. And I go, what's that? But I guess I thought it was a joke, perhaps in dubious taste. It was just an anomaly. And it scrolled past, and then he tweeted again, something like, 17th floor, got to get the kids out now. And so I went to the American geophysical, what's it? I can never remember what it's called, but they have a site that monitors earthquakes pretty much in real time. And there was a huge earthquake off the coast of Japan. So then I went back into Twitter and people were talking about the tsunami and trying to work out the speed and where it was gonna hit. It was starting to get attention, but it was 45 minutes before it made it to mainstream media. And I wound up unable to leave ultimately until very, very early. I was there until very, very early in the morning. Wow. And what was keeping me there was that there were people in Japan, some of them I think in Tokyo, whose cell service was down because of the quake. But I think maybe their tablets were still working. So they were asking on Twitter what they should do. Like, I'm in Shinjuku and the lights are out. And people from all over the world were looking at the news and looking at the Japanese disaster services and telling them what to do. So when I would see someone doing that, I would link them to someone who seemed to know what was going on. And I just found myself unable to quit, because every time I'd tell myself, this is crazy, I've got to quit doing it and go to sleep, another one would pop up. And it was a really strange and moving experience that also fascinated me, because I realized it had no real parallel in previous human experience. It was a completely new sort of experience.
I also think what's interesting in what you're describing here and then contrasting it with describing yourself as a Twitter couch surfer, for lack of a better, you know, or being a Twitter couch potato. And I think all to say is, like, what to me are some of the stakes here? Like, why is this important? You know, why is this discussion about digital identity? Is because, and this has been something that is slightly an artifact of an earlier internet and being on this internet, is that there was this discussion of changing how we would consume and participate in media. and the idea of media being more participatory. There was talk of the cognitive surplus.
Yeah.
And you know, some of that is good rhetoric, but I think part of it also is just realizing that there's that change going on and realizing what are the different ways of making that media more public or more engaged with. And I think that that's why there's a struggle in part about, you know, creating something where you are attentive and consuming, and then also these different ways of actually self-organizing, you know, at the moment of the tsunami. And not to say that neither of them are mutually exclusive, but that there is a tension in there about how we are using these and being aware of some of that potential and that opportunity.
Well, how do you, from moment to moment, distinguish? I mean, when are we being active participants, and when are we being couch potatoes? It seems to me that that distinction is blurred now in some weird way. And so, but you know, I suspect that with broadcast television, we always, a part of its appeal was that while we were being couch potatoes, we imagined that we were being active participants. Mm-hmm. Watching people live tweet television drama gives me that feeling very strongly. That's a weird thing to do with your cognitive surplus.
Bill, you once referred to Google as artificial intelligence, which I thought was an interesting term, because in a way you could think of what's on Google as being our collective intelligence. We are the producers, we are the consumers. Can you explain what you meant by that?
Well, if I can remember what I meant by that, I have a way of coming up with these things and then...
Well, things have evolved, perhaps.
Yeah, things have evolved. I suspect that the context that I said that in was probably a context of considering alternatives to our cultural or possibly folk concept of artificial intelligence, which is like a big robot brain somewhere that is as smart as we are, or maybe way smarter. And it's like Skynet, and it's gonna get us. And that's our cultural model. But from looking at our previous cultural models of technologies that subsequently arrived in one form or another, I've become convinced that we never get the one we imagine. We get something else. The one we imagine is a way of getting our heads around something that we think is looming on the horizon. But we always cast it in a form that's too familiar for it to really resemble the new thing that arrives. And it's occurred to me that it's always seemed to kind of dubious to me that we would get artificial intelligence in that cultural form. But it just seems hokey. It could seem, for instance, more likely to me that an entity like Google that has all of us, or most of us, in some sense contained within it, like the individual living units of a coral reef, could attain a kind of very powerful sentience based on the sheer volume of individual intelligences. And that might be, something like that might be the thing in the real future that, could we go there, we would most recognize as being our like our folk concept of artificial intelligence. I mentioned something that just occurred to me today, and I'm going to selfishly say it again just so I'll have a better chance of remembering it. Is I was having a discussion with someone about something, a very similar topic, and I mentioned Skynet, and I said, but in all of the Terminator franchise, they never suggest what Skynet's motive is, even though it's the really powerful character. It's, you know, the ultimate villain. It's the reason for the whole story. It never says why it's trying to kill all the human beings. As far as I know, I haven't seen the later parts of the franchise. And then it occurred to me that it would be really cool to write a story from the point of view, set in the Terminator universe from the point of view of Skynet. And then it occurred to me that its motivation in killing all the other people is it's an ecologist. It's doing it to prevent the Anthropocene extinction. And it's doing it the quickest way it knows. The quickest way it knows how. Mm-hmm. So if James Cameron is listening, that's a freebie.
Well, it's also interesting when you start imagining, you know, what the motivations are of Skynet, and it never appears as a villain. What we might, how we you know, come to assign some agency to these things, and how we come to kind of imagine it. And I think that's what's often to me very like helpful about science fiction and about some of your work is that, you know, Skynet is a term that we can use and throw around. And, you know, and I think that's one of the things about the power of this and why it has such resonance and how it's, I think, important for us to kind of parse what is this strange moment we're in. But, you know, that Skynet is an untapped villain, and how can we use these terms as a way of provoking or asking these questions about ourselves, and how the latent possibility that Skynet never really is a villain tells us both something about how we're imagining this threat. You know, it's only as the robot coming down, and never as kind of a more mundane articulation. And that's one of the things which is also interesting, in that when some of these technologies arrive, it's in a much more everyday, less magical sense than comes about. And so it's that some of what's helpful, and this is what how you've described your work, is using that to make what seems so mundane actually aware of how significant and how much Skynet is basically, we use Skynet every day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I completely agree. The something else that I'm something parallel that I'm excuse me concerned with in my work is attempting to not attempting to invert the perceived magic of powerful new technologies. I like to imagine powerful new technologies or borrow other people's imagined powerful new technologies and then present them in a kind of what traditionally would be called naturalistic prose, but in a way that allows the reader the illusion of experiencing the character's complete boredom with that yeah. with that technology. I mean, we call Paris and have a conversation in real time with a live human being in Paris, and I really don't think that any of us very often find that miraculous. And yet if you read a piece of 1890s science fiction anticipating a long distance call to Paris, it would be really, really magical. So there's a kind of double bind that I often run into in my in my writing, and that's that in order to write the sort of thing I write, I have to make the imaginary big future technology really, really exciting and magical. And yet at the same time, I'm simultaneously driven to depict it as banal for its users. And I think that was an impulse that I felt when I started writing science fiction that somewhat separated me from most of the science fiction writers whose work I had read. There weren't too many people who were working on that it's magical, it's boring simultaneously thing, which I think is an attempt at a kind of realism, because I think that's how we deal with this stuff and keep from going crazy. I mean, if we were all as excited about all of our personal technology as our personal technology actually warrants, we'd not only be hopeless, but we'd be unbearable. My God. I'm reading something that Patton Oswalt just wrote. My God, I can't, you know.
They just had that thought. I can't believe they shared it. The other thing I wanted to say that is that you're in your work, and I think part of it you're touched upon, but I also think is really accurate, is the mundaneness, but also that I was struck by going and preparing, is that so many of your villains, quote unquote, are ones trying to imagine a future and make that real. And thinking back to Harwood, you know, I want to wake up in a world tomorrow that's radically transfigured and I'm in largely the same place. And I think one of the things when we talk about technology is also what are the drivers behind that. And I think what I witnessed today is the funds and particularly the role, I think, of venture capital in kind of driving what will be the next technologies. And so that thrust of disruption is one that has a kind of deliberativeness to it, and one that I think is really important to kind of question about how much if people hoping to create radical change and that radical change leaves them in the exact same place they were the day before. And I think that that's one of the things which is exciting about reading your writing, and I think also telling in a way of applying it, is being able to understand that what are the forces at work trying to imagine a future and actualize it, and what are those, you know, what are the futures trying to be actualized?
Well, do you think that the kind of assuming that emergent technologies have become, and probably have been for quite a very, very long time, the primary change drivers in human circumstances, given that, do you see the emergence of new technologies as the result of someone, of an individual or individuals wanting radical change? Like what's their motive for, what's their motive for introducing the, what's some hopelessly outdated, the phone pager? Right, the people who, do you think the people who introduced the phone pager wanted to change the systemic structure of a whole lot of different kinds of urban crime?
Well, I mean, but and I think, you know, you're also the one, and I think that this is also as a resonance in communication and culture studies. Like, the street has its own use for things. And 100% is that we witness the kind of different appropriations of technology and at very, very, you know, human rates. And I'm look at like something like podcasting, which has been around for 10, 15 years, and now has only hit this critical mass. And yet I have no clear explanation other than the fact that it just became popular all of a sudden of explaining it. So yeah, I don't think that the technology is a driver, and I certainly think there's lots of unprediction about it. But I also do think there's somewhat of an agency about these things. I mean, in Montreal, we're dealing with this Uber X. And if you would talk to the founders of UberX, they're trying to disrupt the cab market. They're trying to. And so, you know, I think that whether how applicable it is and whether how much they're speaking marketing speak, there is a way of trying to be aware that we are all slightly subjects in a social experiment now, one where the experimenters have limited purview into actually what the effects will be.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I agree with you completely there. I think I think that's a very, very good point. I think that we've come to some sort of tipping point where we can expect agency. But I still think that some of the most significant changes to result from a given emergent technology will be entirely unanticipated by the people who bring it forth, and that applies as much to the guy in the Bell lab dreaming up the phone pager as it does to the people in Uber actively plotting to destroy the cab system. Like, if they really, they go, okay, we're going to throw some way radical change into society around here, and we're going to make an awful lot of money. The more radical, the more money, the more radical, the more money we're going to make. But assuming they're successful, there will be changes that they never anticipated, that nobody anticipated. The street's going to find its own uses for Uber. Yeah. And we don't know what all of them will be.
I'm looking forward to the next season of The Wire, which and its use of Uber in the trade. And you know, I also want to say, because you were talking about dead media, and it'll be interesting what will be my thrift shop of the future. But one of the things that gives me hope is the dead social media that might come my way. You know, what are going to be the all? And there's been, you know, we have Friendster, we have MySpace. There's been a number of these failed websites, and I think of anything to say of some optimism about the power of these sites is that they at some point become unpopular, and how that happens is one we won't see. But will we, in the next 5 to 10 years, look back in the thrift shop of the internet and be like, "Oh, that Facebook T-shirt is so weird"?
Yeah, I mean, why would we? It's kind of nightmarish to think that we wouldn't.
Hey, you know, that's part of my job is to.
Well, I guess that would mean that things just stopped evolving. So let's think about cast ahead to the future then. And one of the quotes that I think certainly you're very famous for is saying that the future has arrived, it's just not evenly distributed yet. How is your understanding and what you meant when you first said that evolved over the course of time?
Well, when I think I don't actually remember when I first said that. I think that I probably said it in an interview, and then, as is my wont, when I got a good line, I continued it to say it in every subsequent interview. And
take notes.
Someone actually collected apparently all of my interviews in a very, very expensive and no doubt incredibly tedious volume. And the one review of it I read said, he does repeat himself rather a lot. I think I said that about the future and its distribution. And as part of an answer to somebody asking me, in effect, where I got my ideas or how I made up the imaginary futures. And I probably say, I don't really make them up. They're bits and pieces of possible futures walking all around here, but we don't necessarily notice them. And I probably said that I was looking for the ones that seemed to me to have legs, that they could go somewhere and then there would be everything would be different. And subsequently, as it's kind of bounced around and become an epigram with a life of its own, whenever I've thought different things, see, you know, it pops up on the internet. And I've thought of it a lot in terms of where technology goes globally and who has the technology and who doesn't have the technology. There are, if you look at an internet map of the world, the technology that takes, the internet's not that very widely distributed. They're big land masses that just don't have much at all, and that's not necessarily because nobody's living there. It's still global, but it's still very localized. And it does seem to me that the district, if your future is going to be driven by something that you buy at a big box store, which it very easily can be, it is going to become more distributed. But then there has to be something else, as you said about the you know, the Friendster shelf at the cultural thrift shop. Friendster's on that shelf because it was supplanted by, I think, because it was supplanted by something else. Every Uber triumphant, imagine they've completely put traditional cab businesses out of business. Who's standing in the wings? Maybe somebody a little younger looking at the Uber execs. And I bet that's a increasingly common slip. Yeah. There's something, someone or something standing in the wings going, radical change, we're going to make a lot of money, we're going to put that out of business. And so it just becomes an endless cycle and some sort of Baroque complication of end-stage capitalism, perhaps.
Well, that phrase, you know, I love that phrase, and I think it's so evocative, a way of questioning things, and one that I almost take even more cynically into, not even playing it out, but in the kind of present. What interests me is not so much the present, is the future, but that distribution. And that, you know, when you talk about Uber, you know, Uber depends upon making taxis obsolescent. And so it's that relationship of who is relegated to the past in order to make sure that future occurs. And I think that one of the things which we're witnessing is kind of the ways that people have a concentration of insight into the future. And this is when we talk about one of the terms that you talked about is the order flow, and how all of our activity on social media is increasingly constituting a way or a sense of that direction, and who has access to that. And so part of that, the future is distributed, not evenly, is that certainly people are in epicenters or concentrations of being forward-looking at the expense of lots of us twittering away at, posting a random thought to the day. And that not necessarily is an answer, but a way of questioning media about media and its time and the unevenness of time, I think is so helpful, I think so important for trying to understand what's going on.
Well, is it... Why would there be any parallel in historically with what you just described? I think of the one-time railway barons of Montreal making their money on CPR, and the people actually used CPR going back and forth, and paying to use it. It's like, who gets, it's a funny, this is a funny world to try to follow the money in, and how someone sitting on a couch flipping their Twitter feed on their iPad is making somebody unspeakably wealthy. And yet, in a sense, we are.
Well, I think, there's two things. It's like, what could be a corollary, earlier? So, like the quiz show, could you get the answers to the quiz before it happened? It's like, there was that scandal movie.
Yeah.
But I think also, it's one of the ways that to talk about this, and I think an important way of talking about social media is the labor involved, and the fact that we're all doing little bits of work. Why is Facebook or Twitter all valuable? It's because of not the company themselves, but the fact that all of us are working for them in our own part way. And I think that comes a question, at least to me, is that as laborers, what rights do we have? And I think that's a kind of political question I'd ask. But I think in terms of following the money, and then I think the next step is where that flow goes. And I think that's one of the questions I often have is, because I'm often struck by one of these companies on the web is called Palantir. Palantir being the crystal ball of the Lord of the Rings. And Palantir is definitely one of these companies mining and selling those feeds to certain companies. And I think that's another question about being able to understand the linkages between some of our social media activities and where those feeds are ending up. I mean, and certainly we know, we found out last week that the CSE is certainly looking at everything that we're done on free file sharing upload sites. And those questions, I think, are more problematic and ones that aren't strictly government problems, but also are corporate problems. And I think that's one of the ways of questioning. And then that's why that quote I find just so evocative.
Oh, that's really interesting. I hadn't quite looked at that. Thank you.
Thank you. I mean,
it's like when you were describing what we might want to have, I was imagining some sort of if we could see some sort of ultimate infographic so that it's not where the money goes, but where does the information go from the individual user up through Palantir to Mordor or wherever?
Well, I think we're almost at the end of the discussion part. We're going to move to audience questions, but maybe let me pose one last question. So, Bill, your new book, Peripheral, has a future and the near future, I guess.
Yes, it's a double scoop.
raising the question, what happens if you know what the future holds? Can you change it? And I saw in one interview you saying that you were feeling a bit pessimistic about the direction we're going in and about the future ahead of us. Can you expand on that? Are you still feeling that way?
Well, yeah, I actually am. It doesn't. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling a bit pessimistic, but I'm a little conflicted because all my life I've been watching, particularly science fiction writers, attain a certain age and then announce, after us, the deluge. This is going down the tubes. And you know, I saw them doing that in the 50s. So, and I know that the ancient Greeks did it. Probably human beings have always done it. The Japanese did it during their bubble, and they called the generation that was born then very scornfully new human beings. I honestly don't know whether I've fallen prey to that, or whether our current condition on the planet and the whole complicated pile of scenarios aren't looking really pretty depressing. So
you don't think Flynn figures it out after knowing what's coming? She doesn't.
I think that I think that the ending of that book, I think of it as a test of the sophistication of the reader's worldview. Because I get the feeling, and I don't want to go into too much detail in case the people who haven't read it, I've gotten the feeling from Twitter, largely, that there's some people who kind of go, well, that's kind of upbeat. Why did he do that? But for me, I found it the creepiest ending I've ever written for a book, because she's sort of okay, and you know, has things that she might want in her life at the end, but the situation she's in is very ominous. Not least which is that her entire world has become a literal conspiracy theory.
That's a good point. All right, well, I think we're going to move to some audience questions. It's a bit hard to see the mics. So there's two mics situated in the room, and we'll just ask people to line up. I think we have about half an hour to take some questions from the audience. Yes, I guess I shouldn't have been careful not to spoiler the ending.
It's the upbeatedness and the. But I mean, in terms of digesting our kind of cultural moment, that I think that partially that optimism was the fact that it had could even have a happy ending, given the jackpot was.
Well, it was hard to find one. It was a job of work. I was getting frightened that there was no way out, that I had written the ball into this terrible, terrible corner. And I think that it might work, but given human nature, it's when Lobeer looks out across the Thames, and when she's been talking with Flynn and says, human, all too human. That's the end of the book. And that, I assume, was Lobeer's comment really on the possibilities of making it right.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll call that microphone one and microphone two. So the gentleman at microphone one.
Hi, good evening. I have a question. I mean, it was during the conversation, it was mentioned how captured you were by the Twitter in Japan and the earthquake. And you mentioned the spreading of the information, but I was always wondering, it concerns me, the quality of the information that is being spread. I mean, we just saw during the Marathon Boston incident, Reddit going after a certain suspect and after was not actually a suspect. So before with the traditional media, we have at least someone taking care of the quality of the information, even though we can discuss how well it was done. But now, how do we know what are we reading? How do we separate the noise from the real information?
Well, there's never a third shooter. We've learned that, but one will always be reported. So I hope that people, I hope that as a society we're building some sort of caution, or that we don't take everything we see on the internet to be real information, because a huge amount of it isn't. And I would hope that someone who's 5 years old now, by the time they're 10, knows that a lot of the stuff she sees on the internet is just hogwash and stuff that people make up or stuff that ignorant people put about without knowing the truth. And we desperately need that in society. That caution, and don't go there. The trouble is, though, that your question brings up is where is the authoritative source in a world like this? For one thing, the authoritative source is well, it's getting better because journalists all follow Twitter, but there were a couple of years where, like, news would break on Twitter and it would take half an hour to an hour for it to get on mainstream media. And it was during that lag that the really crazy disinformation will spread. And there will always be really crazy disinformation. That's that line, there's never a third shooter, is there's an awful truth to that. I mean, there could well be, but every time there's a mass shooting incident, everyone I can remember recently, they always report multiple shooters. And there hasn't been a multiple shooter incident. As soon as it starts, people who are there tweeting go, they're everywhere. They're coming out of the woodwork. And that goes all around the world and makes everybody crazy.
Well, I'd also say two things. Is one, I'm interested in the different ways that we define authoritativeness, right? And, you know, certainly the fact that it comes from a newspaper has been something, is watching, say, the outcome of the second Gulf War is something that was, there's weapons of mass destruction, watching that accountability fail. And so looking at what are some of the different ways that people come to say that this is authoritative or not, and not having the answer, but I think we're in a changing moment about how we can assign authority. And I think there's a potential disruption or an interesting moment in that.
Well, having been in Ottawa covering the shooting, that's, I work out of the Ottawa Bureau, I know that when we were live tweeting what was going on there, we, having learned from what happened in Boston, we were very careful to wait for second and third confirmation, and there were rumors going around of a second gunman, and being very careful not to tweet that irresponsibly and to tweet things and say, source it, or that this is not confirmed, and try to not create news out of false falsehoods. So it's a, you know, evolving at the same time, right?
And if I could say just one last thing, I mean, part of what we try to do when we think of digital technology, we forget structural issues and, you know, the issues of race and class and gender. I mean, all those things which I think are front and center and things that we need to bring to bear all the time when we talk about this technology. It's, I mean, and those are things that I think are disconcerting, and it's just a different media, but those concerns I think are enduring, unfortunately, you know, and ones that we always need to bring critical attention to.
And microphone number two.
I found this discussion extremely interesting, including the ending of the search for authoritative source. What I have been fascinated is this rate of change, of social change and technological change. In 1970, Alvin Toffler wrote a book called, now I forgot the name. Future Shock, thank you. Future Shock, where he showed in much, very convincingly, that change is accelerating. Recently, the head of IBM, a lady whose name I forgot, said change is occurring so fast, much faster than ever before. The internet itself only exists for a little over 20 years. In 1994, a Mosaic and Netscape introduced internet in its user-friendly form. The same year, the World Trade Organization was created. In the same year, GMO food were created. In the same year, 50 years is enough, the first anti-globalization NGO coalition was created. I think everything together, tightly interconnected, really has changed the world, I think. And I am also pessimistic in the global context, because first of all, the equity question is disastrous. The rich and the poor are more and more splitting apart. And also, the whole digital system is very, very energy, highly energy consuming, and also consumes large amounts of rare earths, which are very, very polluting and toxic in their disposal. So I think we are heading into, and I would end by saying ISIS, I think, is an outgrowth, among other things, not only that, but among other things, out of these enormous social tensions, which are the result of this technological flow.
Well, I think that's an excellent point. And we didn't talk very much about class in our conversation. But that's how I always had kind of interpreted that future comment, as being partly about who had access.
And, yeah.
You know, the fact that you could be in rural Africa and have access to the internet but not have sewage, which is a contradiction that you've pointed out. Do you want to comment on some of those issues the gentleman was raising?
Well, I mean, with the peripheral, say, it seems to me that the biggest change driver in the nearer future scenario is, can easily be seen to have been the end of a North American middle class, as I was about to say, as we know it, but I think actually it's as we knew it, because I think it's at least partially gone. Apparently, 1967 was the peak year economically for the American middle class, and it's been going down ever since. And I'm starting to suspect that all of the things, paradoxically, all of the things that made me most optimistic in my teens were not the result of the counterculture, but the result of having a middle class that was doing really, really well. In fact, there only was, I think, a counterculture because there was a middle class that was doing very, very well. And as that middle class does less well, and if I can believe the statistics I see on Twitter, the divide between wealth and poverty in the United States is now worse than it was during the Great Depression. Cool. So if those, you know, if it's a grim thing, but with the distribution of the future bits of technology through along lines of class, it's interesting because it doesn't go the way. It doesn't go strictly by lines of class. It can hit something in a ghetto that can go in a completely unexpected direction and change everything. So it won't, a given piece of technology won't, a rich man's use for it won't necessarily be a poor man's best use for it.
I also liked in the peripheral, you know, the line you had, the constant crisis creates constant opportunity. I think if I'm correct, you know, yeah. We're talking. And I mean, all to say is that those people feeling, and I think we can talk about where it feels like we're feeling a future shock. And I'd put a plug on YouTube. The video for Future Shock is amazing. That, you know, who is feeling the real future shock is very different than, you know, is there's a distribution in that. And who are the people that, as a public, we're exposed to these intense, like a feeling of this intense future. And then you look at kind of imagination labs and that the future feeling much more mundane to certain people. And that the fact that strategic deployment of shocks is something that can be quite profitable in future and in many other things that we've discovered.
I'll go to microphone number one. And just remember to keep your questions short so we can go through as many as possible.
What scale of revolutionary political change do you think is possible through global connectivity on social media? I mean, you seem pessimistic, but is there any chance that Web 2.0 technologies can, you know, save us all? Tell us.
I'm doing a talk. I got to plug a talk on the Concordia Solidarities. I'm going to blank on the name, but anyways, it's last minute. But I'm doing a talk slightly, but I am actually. More pessimistic at this point, just because I think that we've witnessed the construction of an internet that is very different than some of the optimism I had attached to it. And I think that part of what we need to be critical about is just about how much our activities exist on social media, which is, we now know, easily subject to government surveillance and easily and designed and purposely for corporate surveillance. And I think that part of what was radical initially about the internet was its use as a tactical media, about being advantageous. I mean, you know, certainly it's like the turntable in New York was certainly something quite disruptive at a time. I mean, and so all to say is that, you know, is to be critical about media use and to not attribute the success of change to being a technology, but about how people find and make use of any technology to make change.
So
to be optimistic.
We have time for one more question. So from microphone two, please keep your question short.
All right, I'll try. I also just wanted to say thank you for coming, and I really love the comment about us all being workers with workers' rights. And I want to thank William Gibson, especially for coming to Montreal. I saw you in London at Forbidden Planet. You signed the peripheral for me, thank you. And now you're here in my city. So my question is this, as a big fan of your writing, what I really love is your social criticism and how it's clever and funny, at times very funny, and also very scary. And a lot of people have praised your work as being extremely prescient, like you've foreseen things that just happened. And you know, but I actually see it as a lot of science fiction writers pretend to be writing about the future when we're really writing about the present. Yeah. And I think that you're just extraordinarily good at seeing the present more than most people. And so my question for you is, what do you think are the special tools of someone writing science fiction to do a very relevant social commentary about the present?
Well, I think that the way the world has worked out, then it's, I think it's impossible to write a naturalistic novel set in the present that doesn't have to deal with the impact on the characters in the novel of all sorts of wildly science fictional scenarios. So without the tools of that science fiction created to deal with those scenarios, how is a writer to deal with contemporary reality? It's in order to write, I think it's getting to the point that in order to write a naturalistic novel that doesn't have to deal with the impact of very science fictional scenarios, you have to go historical. If you're, you know, it's fine, get back before the climate changed. But to do anything contemporary, I think poor old science fiction wound up with the toolkit. And that may ultimately, I hope, further erode the walls of genre, because there'll be more literary writers necessarily, you know, borrowing the toolkit and learning how to use it.
Well, we'll look forward to your next contribution. Thank you so much, William Gibson, for coming to Montreal, and Fenwick McKelvey for being here. And thanks to all of you for coming tonight. There is a book signing outside. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was amazing.